Many people use the word meditation, but a more appropriate word for this would be mental culture, to culture the mind. Now, how do we culture our mind? How do we cultivate our mind? What is the process of cultivation? If we are to compare, just as we want to cultivate a small piece of land, a plot of land to grow some plants, what do you do first things? You first plow it, and then after that? Think, what do you do? You? So which one do you do first? You clear undergrowth or you plow first? You clear the? Yeah. You clear all the weeds. You remove the weeds. You remove all the undergrowth. And then when it is clean, you plow it. You're not a farmer. If you plow first, all the weeds grow inside, and you will have a hard time. When you grow, you know, only the weeds will grow very fat and strong, no? And first thing is, we need to weed out, remove the weeds, or at least we try to suppress the growth of the weeds. Until such time when we plant, when we sow the seeds, and we have to nurture, we have to look after it, right? Sometimes we have to put some, you know, wire also. We have to put some wire fencing because there are some itchy hands. Not animals, we're not talking about animals, we're talking about human beings, you know. I see how you all stand there, some itchy hands, you know, we just go to the plant and pick one branch and got enough. We just pull the leaves for nothing and tear the leaves to bits and these are human beings. That's why when the government plant the trees on the roadside, they have to put fence. And that is one thing. Besides that, of course, there are birds. There are birds and various other animals that like to take the seedling, the young plants, the young shoots, they will take it off. So we have, in order to, after we have planted the seed, we have to look after it. We have to water it, and then we guard it from being destroyed by other beings, including human beings. So this is the process by which we cultivate the land. Now you are not farmers. You are another kind of farmers. What do you farm? You know, talking about farmers during the time of the Buddha. The Buddha once ran around with a begging bowl, and he went to the village. And there was this one Brahmin. He had a big farm. The Buddha went there to collect some food. The Brahmin saw him from far. Then Brahmin went to him, and Brahmin asked him, "What do you want?" And Buddha said, "You know that I've come through for alms rounds. You can whatever you like, you can offer like that." And he said, "Why don't you work for yourself? Why you come to beg for your food. Why don't you work? You should also work. You see, we have to work. We have to sow. We farm and we work on the land. And so why do you only come and take the food only? If he says, if you want to eat, you must farm. You must work for yourself. Then what did the Buddha say? Buddha told him, I am also a farmer. Then the Brahmin looked at him and said, where are your tools? Huh? Where is your plowshare? Where is your... Where do you work? How do you work? How do you farm? Then the Buddha said, I found my mind. My mind. The good seeds. I sow good seeds. I cultivate my mind. And like that. You see? And then the Buddha, seed, a good seed, and I nurture it. I do work too. I work on my mind like that. And there's a beautiful discourse on that. How the Buddha explained, I cannot remember now everything. But in essence, the Buddha says, like, you know, the field is my mind. And I sow the seeds. And then the reins of the plowshare. I use mindfulness for that. Mindfulness is my rein, like that. And very beautifully how the Buddha compared. So if anybody come and tell you, if you go around and then you are also another kind of farmer. But you must truly farm your mind. You must truly cultivate your mind. If you don't cultivate your mind, then you are not a farmer. So we work. We also work. But we are unemployed like that. So farming of the mind means to cultivate the mind, just as we cultivate the land. So we should cultivate our mind, and just as we remove the weeds from the land, so we should try to remove the weeds in our mind. What are the weeds in your mind? Yes, all the defiling tendencies, all the defilement in your mind, they are like the weeds, like the weeds which entangle like that. So we have to pull them up one by one like that. And as long as we are not able to root it out, Still it will grow. At the most, sometimes we pick it up, and then after that, when it grows up, again we pick it up, like that. Until the tree that we want to plant, now it grows very strong already, and the weeds cannot catch up anymore. So the seeds, like your aspiration, the good thoughts that you have in your mind, your aspiration, and you have to nurture until it grows like that, and until your mind becomes strong, then the weeds cannot catch up with you. Right. So mental culture or bhavana, where we talk about bhavana, there are three important ingredients, three important components. What are the components? Like some people talk about meditation. What do they mean by meditation? What are the important factors in meditation or mental culture? Anybody knows? I tell you three things. Wisdom you get as a result of the mental culture. Mental culture, what are necessary factors? What are the necessary factors, necessary components for mental culture to culture your mind? Sati, mindfulness, is one. That's mindfulness, one. How you prolong it? Yes, go ahead. So? Okay. Anybody else? Huh? Very good. You need effort. You need what you call right effort. Yes, right effort to maintain the good that is already there. You have to maintain. The good that is not there, you have to cultivate. So you need effort. You need mindfulness. One more. Concentration. So these are the three components. Or you have effort, mindfulness, and concentration. These are the three important ingredients of what we call mental culture or mental discipline. To discipline your mind, you need these things. Right? You know what right effort is? What is right effort? Can you remember? Effort to avoid unwholesome thoughts from arising in the mind. Two, if it has arisen, you need an effort to overcome it. Right? That's the second effort. Third effort is you try to maintain the good that is already there. And fourth, two, to develop, to cultivate the good that is not there. These are the four efforts. Any more? You can summarize this as avoiding evil and doing good. The first two things to avoid unwholesome thoughts from arising in the mind, and to overcome it. And that's what you call avoid evil, like that. Yeah? Then, to maintain the good that is there, and to promote, to develop the good that is not there. These two things with regards to good. So you see, avoid evil and do good, like that. So these are the two. These are the right efforts. Continuously, we have to exert this kind of effort. And this effort is actually what we call energy. And where do we derive this energy from? Right understanding and right thought. Yes, someone? From confidence, from sattva. And how do you develop this sattva? How do you develop this confidence? You see, it's only when you have confidence, when you have sattva, that you will have energy. Energy will arise in you. How do you develop this confidence? First important thing is the Buddha said is if you want to develop yourself, you should have group association. Association with the wise. Group association. You see, when you have friends that are good and the friends that know how to counsel you when you are down, when you are in problem, when the friend can talk, can encourage you, then you get the energy. But if you mix with some people, sometime when you are already down, you go and talk to that person, and the person go and add in some more, and say, oh yeah, and do all the kind of complaining, and then the mind of that person become weaker like that, and lose all energy. And when the person don't have confidence, then he cannot practice. But that is why it is important for us to learn how to give confidence to others. When you associate with people who are faithful, who have faith, who have confidence, you gain that kind of confidence. You look what they do, they are happy. If you have some people sitting around you and they are able to sit straight throughout the session, and you feel like sleeping and nodding off, but when you look at him, you get some kind of influence like that. You also sit. Now this is the advantage of group sitting. But the moment you see somebody start to stretch themselves, try to change the posture, and then you also start to change the posture. Like infectious disease like that. Because you think, oh, he's doing, I also, like that. You must make an effort. If he wants to do, let him do. I will not do. Like that. That is your effort. And then you can help that person to realize. But if he gives up, you also give up like that. Then you are influenced by that. Easily influenced by that. So, effort, your energy you get from when you have confidence. When you have confidence in the Buddha, the Dhamma and the Sangha. I think this one you can see for yourself. Those people who have a lot of faith, a lot of confidence in religion, they have energy. They can walk for miles and miles and miles in pilgrimage. They don't feel tired. The women folk can come to temple and do so much work, yet they don't feel tired. Like that. I told you last time of how some people go for pilgrimage to Buddhist holy places. They have faith, they have confidence, they don't feel tired. So they get the energy and they don't become sick so easily. But once, if you do not have that confidence, you don't have the faith, your energy drains away, like husband and wife. When a husband and wife live, they are faithful to one another, they are good, the wife can work very hard. Even if she go out to work, she come back, she can do many things, and she is not tired. She don't feel tired. She's happy. She can work some more. But the moment she suspect that the husband is not faithful, then she gets worry in the mind, anxiety, worry, fear in the mind. And then she do a little bit, she feel tired, and then start to grumble, start to nag like that. You have seen. Do you know this one? This is why, because of the element of faith, the element of confidence is not in the mind. And you can see for yourself, if you don't have faith in your teacher, like if your teacher comes and you don't have faith, you don't have confidence, your mind cannot concentrate. Your mind is here, there, everywhere. You eat kacang and you eat everything. And you cannot concentrate. But if you have faith, if you have confidence, your mind is set on that. You have the energy to go on. That is what is important. Afterwards, we will talk about the mental faculties, how through this energy you channel your energy to have right effort like that. Then the other ingredient of meditation or mental culture is what we call mindfulness. We'll just leave it at that because we have a lot to talk about mindfulness. When we want to practice mindfulness, there are four things that we should, four foundations, we call it the four foundations of mindfulness. In other words, to develop our mindfulness, we should take our mind to these four things. What are these four things? Yes, very good. The four foundation of mindfulness. Mindfulness on the body. The first one. Second one. Mindfulness on feelings. Third. Mindfulness on the mind or the state of mind. And fourthly, mindfulness on Dhamma or mental objects. Are you right? To overcome, prevent and overcome evil, right? And the effort to maintain and develop the good. These are the four kinds of effort. With regards to mindfulness, we develop our mindfulness by bringing our attention, by focusing on these four things. They are called the foundations, the four foundations of mindfulness. What are these four foundations of mindfulness? Mindfulness on the body, mindfulness on feelings, mindfulness on mind, that is the state of your mind, and mindfulness on mental objects. We will spend more time to talk about these four things and in more detail later. For the time being, you just have to try to remember these four things, and then we will elaborate how you develop mindfulness on the body. Although some of you have already got that kind of experience, I see. That is why I try to make your sitting longer, but some of you have no endurance, no patience. Actually, if you really make effort by now, when you sit, you can get into your calmness and concentration more quickly like that. Actually, we all take a few days. Every time we go for retreat, the first few days, we like get used to the environment. We have to get used to the food. We have to get used to the new situation. We take a few days for our body to adjust ourselves. And then after that, then the peak, you reach the climax of your practice will be somewhere in the middle. Towards the end, the last 2-3 days, your thoughts go back again. Very difficult for us to control also. Like now, I think if you have made an effort, if you can make your effort, now your mind it's good this period you can practice because now you got used to it already, and then but sometimes you feel a little bit tired, you feel a little bit, try to arouse energy in yourself, and make an effort, put in a little bit greater effort like this. And because towards the end, your thoughts will come to you that, you know, oh, you, how to go back, how to face this, and this responsibility, that responsibility, all these things will come. Don't allow it to come out now, still, You should still enjoy the kind of the blissful contentment here now. If it arises, you just observe it. Don't cling to it. Just let it go like that. Then you watch your mindfulness on the body. There are different aspects by which you can develop your mindfulness on the body. The first way to develop, one of the most common way to develop mindfulness on the body, is just to watch your breath. This is the breath of the body, breath of the body. And so when you watch your breath, I think some of you get the kind of experience, after you watch your breath, your mind is calm, and then cannot, like there is no more breath. And when there is no more breath, you try to cling to the breath. You force a little bit, and then you feel a little bit constricted like that. The breath is a little bit like tight like that, because you cling to your breath. When there is no breath, okay, give up the breath. You know? But you must have awareness. It's not that you are not breathing. You are breathing, but your mind is now. Your mind is now more calm and mindful, and the breath becomes very subtle, very subtle, very refined, like that. And actually, it is long breath. If you cannot observe the breath at that point, what you do is, you should turn your attention to look at your feelings. And if there is no feeling, just observe how your body make the touch on your seat. The point where your body touches the seat, the ground, you can feel the touch. Or you can feel the touch of your robes, your clothes, on your body. Can you feel it? And you just observe that. Just observe your posture. This is how you turn your attention from the body to the feelings. And after you watch the feeling, and sometimes if you have painful sensation also, you should see the painful sensation when your mind is calm, and see how the pain rise and fall. Rise and fall. And if you train your mind to see the painful sensation rise and fall, sometimes the itchy sensation come up, and then you want to scratch. Don't scratch, just look at it and see. And then you will see how the itch come. Oh, it reaches like a peak like that, very itchy, and then after that, it goes away. And then another one come. And go away like that. And so if you can train the mind to see it in the air, then you will see one after a little while the feeling to go away. No more feeling. And then you get afraid. If you have no strong awareness, fear arises in your mind. Like, how is it now? My body, no feeling already. Fear can arise. At that time, when that arises, you should not be afraid, and you make your mind firm, because you can turn your attention towards your mind. Because naturally,
if you can watch your feeling, and if your feeling, you know, become very subtle, refined, and then your mind become very sensitive. You become very sensitive to the thoughts that arises in your mind. And so you should turn your attention and watch your thoughts, watch your state of mind. The Buddha's mind was so sensitive, the Buddha's mind was so sharp, that the Buddha was able to divide those thoughts into various thought moments also. One thought process, from the time one thought arises, the Buddha was able to see that this thought arises, how this thought arises, and divide this thought into 17 thought moments. And what is the duration of your thought? How long do you take to think? Did you time yourself? You try and time yourself. Okay, I tell you, now can you think of your home? Okay, think already. How much time did you take to go home? You don't think like that. Like that. Split second. Faster than the speed of light. Which travels faster, light or sound? Light. That's why you see the lightning first, then you hear the thunder, isn't it? Your mind, your thoughts can travel much faster than that. You're here, your mind can go around the world, I don't know, some of you have gone around the world many times already with your mind. And to and fro, go back, come back, go back, come back, like that. And this is what the mind. And you should watch the state of your mind. When we say watch the mind, means you should know the state of your mind. What kind? What state of mind? If there is anger, you know there is anger. If there is desire, craving, you know there is desire, there is craving. If the mind is confused, you know there is confusion. If your mind is concentrated, you should know your mind is concentrated. If your mind is not concentrated, you know your mind is not concentrated, like that. So you know the state of your mind. I see some of you walk, and you do your walking meditation, like you close your eyes and you do not know why it's happening like that, no? And make yourself aware. You must be aware. If you just walk and like no awareness like that, that is not how you practice mindfulness, concentrate. When you walk, your mind should be there, and at the same time, you know, you can sense what you call outside. Sometimes you can hear sound, but you don't cling to it. Only thing, you don't cling to it, and you just observe one thing like that. And when you are walking like this in a group, you should have more a kind of awareness and there is a certain time that you should walk in pace and go out. If you want to take your own, say, time, when you are practicing your own, it's okay, like that. You can walk to and fro quietly, and if you feel drowsy, you should walk fast, like that, to get rid of your drowsiness. And then when your mind calm again, you walk slower, like that, you see? Because if you walk too slow, if you are drowsy, sleepy, you walk slow, you will fall down. Because you cannot. So you must know the balance like that. And there are There are various ways by which you can practice mindfulness. You must mindfulness on the mind and mindfulness on Dhamma. When you watch your mind, when you watch the thoughts that arises in your mind, and eventually all the thoughts will go away. The thoughts come and it goes like that. And then your mind become clear. And the Dhamma arise. The Dhamma arise. The real Dhamma will arise. Then when the Dhamma arise, that you can see, you can contemplate on anicca, dukkha, anatta. And because when you see the mind keep on, for everything, you see the body, your breath changes, little while short, little while long. And you look, if you keep on looking at your feelings, you see your feeling also, little while pleasant, little while unpleasant. It changes. And you look at the state of your mind, how fleeting the thought come and go, like that. And when everything you have observed this thing, the real Dhamma come to your mind, you see everything just rise and fall, rise and fall, rise and fall. And you know anicca, and you know unsatisfactoriness. Anicca, dukkha, anatta, and then the Four Noble Truth can arise in your mind. Like this, like when you see unsatisfactoriness, you will know the cause of it. You know the end, you know the path that leads to the end of it. Now, that suffering, that unsatisfactoriness, sometimes when you sit down for a longer time, you can feel the pain, right? You can feel the pain. And the pain stay, if the pain stay long time, and if your mind is clear, you try to look and see, you will find the cause of that pain. What is the cause of the pain? What is the cause of a painful sensation? You're clinging, because you cling to your feelings. Then you feel the pain. If you let go of the feeling, like, you see the feeling come and go, don't claim the feeling to be yours. The feeling is not yours. If you see the feeling, it come and go, come and go, come and go. Like, you can sit and you just watch the feeling come and go, come and go. Not mine. You don't claim the feeling. You don't suffer the pain. But if the feeling come and you cling it, you say, oh, my leg is painful. Then you feel the pain. Is it really that your leg is painful? Can you remove that part of your leg and then throw away? You think you can remove the pain? You cannot remove the pain. The pain comes somewhere else. It's your mind. Painful sensation, feeling. Feeling is part of the mind. So you must use your mind to confront, to free your mind from that. The body can only be a cause of it. A cause. Pain can arise conditioned by the body or conditioned by the mind. Conditioned by body or mind. But the feeling itself, the feeling of the painful sensation is mental. It is not body. It is not material thing. The feeling is mental. We will talk about that when we start to define and go in further detail about these four foundations of mindfulness. In fact, it is when we talk about these four foundations of mindfulness that we cover everything in the teachings of the Buddha. Everything that is most basic, most fundamental in the teachings of the Buddha. All the other things, dana, sila, bhavana, dana, sila, it is just to like something that we should know about the tradition and something that we can lead us up to this stage like that, the foundation. Yeah? But the real essential of the Dhamma is this foundation of mindfulness. Because the Buddha say in the Satipatthana Sutta, Buddha say, Ekayano ayang makko. Buddha say, oh monk, this is the only way, Ekayano ayang makko. This way is the only way. What? Sattanang visuddhiya. For the purification of being. Sattanang visuddhiya. Soka parideva samatikamaya. For the overcoming of sorrow and lamentation. The only way to overcome sorrow and lamentation. Dukkha domanasanang atangamaya. For the destruction of mental and physical suffering. Nyayasa adigamaya. For the attainment, for the realization of insight, knowledge, of real knowledge and insight. Nyayasa, jnana. Nyayasa adigamaya, to reach that knowledge, to lead that, to reach that insight. Nibbanasa sachikriyaya, for the realization of Nibbana. There is this only way. And what is this only way? Yaridam chattaro satipatthanam. Buddha says, through these foundation, the four foundations of mindfulness. Buddha did not say that, you know, Buddhism is the only way like that. My teaching is the only way. If you can find any teaching that teaches you how to develop your mindfulness, and if it touches on mindfulness, body, feelings, mind, like that, you can free your mind too. But you can find out. Some teaching have some aspect, but the Buddha's teaching is very clear in all the aspects, very systematically lead you up to that stage. We will first talk about concentration a little bit to give general idea, and then we will go back again and talk in more, in greater detail about what this mindfulness of the four foundations of mindfulness is about. What is right concentration? Concentration is concentration with awareness. You should have concentration with awareness. At any point of time when we have concentration without awareness, that is wrong concentration. You know, people can sit to meditate. They close their eyes, and they meditate and become like a stone. Yes. All you have to do is think of a stone and try to become that stone. When you think of a tree, look at a tree and think you are a tree, like that. Eventually no feeling, no, you know. Yes, you come to the state of no feeling. And you don't hear anything, you don't smell anything, everything like that. But is that useful to you? Because useful to some extent, for temporarily. But when you get up of it, still You have your anger, still a lot of desire, lustful thoughts, still a lot of other defilements in your mind. So that kind of concentration is not so useful. And that is why the Buddha taught about right concentration. Some people can sit for a long time, but their mind is not aware. They can see. The mind have no awareness. Like that. You should have awareness. Or if the moment you lose your awareness, sometimes you sit in your mind, you feel calm, and you sit calm, and you cling to that calmness, the next thing is you go to sleep. That's it. And some your mind blank like that. Oh, you think, oh, now no thought, sunyata, already blank. Your mind must be active. Your mind must see it clearly. And you know the knowing is very strong like that. Very awareness is strong, very subtle like that. So, concentration. When we talk about concentration, there are different levels of concentration. In theory, we speak about what you call Kanika Samadhi. That is, Kanika Samadhi means momentary concentration. Momentary concentration. Like when you are listening to me or you are seeing something on the board, you have concentration. But momentary, moment to moment like that, you know? One moment you concentrate, another moment cannot concentrate. And a few moments you can concentrate for 1 minute, after that, lose the concentration, like that. This moment to moment concentration. Then there is what we call excess concentration. Upachara Samadhi. Upachara Samadhi is when your mind, after you have calmed down your mind, you can feel sometimes that your mind just become very a bit still, and you feel calm, sudden calmness like that. But you are aware of it. You can think about things. That is the Upachara Samadhi state. Upachara Samadhi. And then the next state, next level is what you call the Appana Samadhi. That is when your mind is in full concentration, in full absorption or jhana, full absorption. Your mind is just one, but very clear and have clear awareness. So these are the three kind of, but in practice, you know, in practice, this concentration can arise anytime. If you develop again and again, again and again, you know, we cannot say must first this, that, this, that. Sometimes it can come any direct. Right. To understand really how we can develop our concentration and have right concentration, we must understand what. Firstly, we must understand our mental faculties and how we can develop our mental faculties. So, now we shall touch on what we call the five mental faculties. Do you know your mental faculties? Sati, Samadhi, Panya. These are the five mental faculties. Mental faculties. Saddha. Is the first one is faith or confidence. The second one is virya, means effort or energy. The third one is sati, mindfulness. Fourth, samadhi. The first one is faith or confidence. The second one is virya, means effort
or energy. The third one is sati, mindfulness. Fourth, samadhi, or concentration. And fifthly, panya, wisdom. Now these are the five mental faculties. It is called faculties in the sense that the mind has the potentiality to develop this, the potentials, just like in the university you have different faculties, right? What faculties you have? Faculty of medicine, you have, you have economics faculty, and so on. And you go there to develop your skills in that, you go to that faculty to develop the potentials. So also we talk about the five mental faculties. The first faculty of the mind is what we call saddha. You see, the beauty of the teachings of the Buddha is that when you study the teaching systematically, you will find that there is the interrelations, the connection. You have come across these words again and again. When you study Four Noble Truths, you will study the Noble Eightfold Path. When you study the Noble Eightfold Path, the Noble Eightfold Path also contains the Four Noble Truths also. Like that. When you talk about right understanding, you talk about understanding of Four Noble Truths. So, when you talk about Four Noble Truths, you talk about right understanding. It is, you cannot go very far away from the Four Noble Truths and the Noble Eightfold Path. In fact, the whole teachings, the whole fundamentals of the teachings of the Buddha lies in that core, the Four Noble Truths and the Noble Eightfold Path. We only develop these things from there. So if you can try to put your mind back and focus into this Four Noble Truths, Noble Eightfold Path, you won't be far wrong. Like that. Yes. Now we talk about saddha, confidence, faith and confidence. In what? Of course, as a Buddhist, we naturally would talk about our faith and confidence in the Buddha, faith and confidence in the Dhamma, and faith and confidence in the Sangha. Faith, confidence in the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha. Understand? That's what you call faith. When you have faith in the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha, you have energy. Now, when you have faith in Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha, what you really have is you have faith in moral and spiritual values, moral, spiritual, as well as intellectual values too. Because the Buddha does not neglect the intellectual part, the logic, the reasoning part. The only thing is that at a certain point, the Buddha transcends logic, go beyond logic, go beyond reason. And that is how we understand confidence, faith. And when you have faith in good action, your mind will be very strong. You can make decisions. And like sometimes you come to a point where you have to make important decisions in your life. And if you have confidence in good action and you think and you know this is the right way, this is the right path, you decide on that path, the right way, and you don't worry what comes. And because if you go the right path, the right way, like that, and that Dhamma
If that is real Dhamma, it will protect you like that. No? That is how you get confidence. And when you have, and you go the right path, and you see how, you know, you get the right support, the right kind of, and then you have more confidence. Or when you study this Dhamma, and then you apply it in your day-to-day life, and after you apply, you see the good results of it, and then you know you have more confidence, you have more energy to practice like this. Huh? You know it is possible, you develop your energy. And that's how actually these mental faculties, one conditioning the other, one conditions the other. When there is faith, there is confidence, that faith and confidence condition virya, energy. Where there is no faith, what happens is the mind becomes weak, and the other, what you call anxiety, worry, fear can arise in the mind very easily. No? So if you have strong faith, strong confidence, then you can overcome fear, you can overcome worries. And virya. Faith conditions virya, energy. And you direct that energy to the right effort. Right? And with effort, with energy, with effort, you develop your mindfulness. Your mindfulness is you direct your attention to your body, feelings, mind, and mental object. Right? When your mind goes out again, you bring back again to it. Again it goes, again you bring back. To bring back it again and again, you need what you call energy. You need effort. Huh? Right? You need effort to bring back again. So every time you are doing something, if you apply your right effort, you will have the joy in you. But if you give up and you know, like you don't care to have the right effort to maintain your effort, then you will feel very dull, very bored, very, because there is no Dhamma at that time. But if you have the Dhamma, if you keep that effort and keep on persevering, never mind, you know, because of the bad habit in the past, you're bound to make mistake again. Like, you know, if you have spent a few days and you take rest and you sleep and sleep, after, you know, after you listen Dhamma talk, you go and sleep, and then you come back, and then after that you go and sleep again, like, when your body feels tired, you give in again. Actually, sometimes our body feels tired, it's not because that we don't have enough sleep, because we don't have enough oxygen, and so a little exercise is useful. Of course, we don't have, you know, we cannot exercise the way that people do. What we do is we do some simple exercise. We have deep breath, we walk, and we take the broom and sweep, like exercise. We can stretch ourselves, do little yoga, and after you have exercise, and you can massage and pull your ear like this, and you feel fresh again, right? Then you don't have to go to sleep. When you go to sleep, you get up, your mind blur, your eyes red like that. Unless you are very tired. You know why you feel tired? Because, like, you know, you have habit, the past, you have accumulated so many habits in the past. So these habitual tendencies come up, you know. And your way of life now is different. So it come up. What you do is, first few days, like, you have
energy to you control it, you suppress it like that, you suppress it like that, no? Huh? But when you lose, sometimes you get a bit tired, huh? You lift your leg up and come up again. You know, like the grass. Huh? If you put your feet on the grass, huh? And stand there for a long time, the grass cannot grow, no? Huh? The grass is suppressed. The moment you lift your feet, the grass come out again. Right? Yeah. So when you lose your mindfulness, like you lose your energy, you like that, then all the bad habits come out again. Like you feel want to smoke. If you are smoking, you feel want to smoke. Or if you have been eating, you know, 5-6 times a day, yeah, in between meals, you feel like you want to eat some more, huh? Or you want to listen, you want to enjoy. All these things come up. And then you, again, keep it, check it like that, suppress it like that. Until you can have your mind become clear and you can understand why is it important for you to check. And then you will not have so much suppression. You will do it with understanding. When you do the thing with understanding, with right understanding, then you don't suffer from suppression. But in the beginning, sometimes we have to calm down our mind and keep it down first, until we develop our mind to be able to understand and see the real nature. Then we have real confidence, unshakable confidence, like that. So when you have that sati, mindfulness, and where there is sati, that sati can condition your concentration, your mindfulness, your can condition, give rise, can condition concentration. And then where you have concentration, you can analyze, you can contemplate, and you can analyze, and then you can see cause and effect. You can understand, this has a reason because of these causes, like that. So you understand cause and effect. When you start to understand cause and effect, that's what we say wisdom. Mundane wisdom, the worldly wisdom, is the understanding of cause and effect. And further concentration, your mind becomes clear, bright, and eventually you can see the true nature of things. You see things as they are, and then you can realize the Four Noble Truths, Noble Eightfold Path. And then that is what you call the supramundane wisdom, realizing the Four Noble Truths. Now you only have intellectual understanding of Four Noble Truths, but not realized yet. And just like you have intellectual understanding of greed, hatred, and ignorance, but you have not fully experienced them yet. And you should, like, when the greed and the desire or anger arises, you should know it. And once you know it, it will go away. Okay. That is the experiential level, at the experiential level. In conventional language, we say like we have to remove our greed, hatred, and delusion. Actually, there's nothing to remove. It is there. It's just for us to see it and it go away. You just observe like that, it go away. You don't believe you can see. Sometimes when you feel tired and you feel drowsy, you just look at your state of mind. Look carefully. You watch it come and go, and then it goes away. It doesn't stay for long. But if you cling to it, then it stays longer time, like that. And, these five things, mental faculties, we use in order to have right concentration. In order to have right concentration, you must know how to develop these mental faculties in order to overcome your mental hindrances. You know what your mental hindrances are? There are also five mental hindrances. What are these five mental hindrances?
The five mental hindrances are, first one is kamachanda. Kamachanda. That is sensual desires. Kamachanda. The second one is vyapada. Vyapada. Vyapada is anger or aversion. The third one, tinamidda, tinamidda. Tinamidda means sloth and torpor, sloth and torpor. Fourth one, udaccha kukkuccha, very long word. Udaccha kukkuccha. You can spell your own way, never mind. As long as you get the right pronunciation. Udaccha kukkuccha. And then, udaccha kukkuccha means restlessness. And vichikicca means doubt. Now these are the five mental hindrances. First one, kamachanda. Kamachanda. What is kamachanda? Two words, kama and chanda. Desire for kama. Kama is sensuality. Sensuality. Sensual desires. Kamachanda. Then, when you have sensual thoughts in the mind, then your concentration comes down again. Block. It is a hindrance in the sense that it obstructs, it blocks your concentration power. When you have anger, when you have aversion, you cannot concentrate. When you are angry, you try to concentrate. Sometimes when you get angry and you try to read your book, you cannot. You cannot read. Your mind get upset. That's what you call aversion. Hindrance. It hinders your concentration. Third one, tina mitta, sloth and torpor. What is the meaning of sloth and torpor? You know what sloth and torpor is? Your mind, when you want to think, your mind just refuses to think like that. Your mind becomes heavy and blank and I don't want to think. And when you did, when you cannot think like that, what happens? A little while more, your drowsiness. Sloth and torpor, your drowsiness is conditioned by sloth and torpor of the mind. And then, udaccha kukkuccha, udaccha kukkuccha, restlessness of the mind. This restlessness, sometimes your worry, you have some worry or something that you have done wrong in the past come up in your mind, remorse like that. You feel remorse. It disturbs your mind. Something good which you should have done and you have not done like that. And again, remorse can arise in your mind. So that's your kukkuccha. And then, vichikicca, doubts. You have doubts. Various kinds of doubts. In the beginning, when you practice the method and you have doubt in the method, also your concentration block. You cannot develop further. So that's why you must try to clear your doubts. And sometimes, if you have, when something you experience, and you don't know, you have doubt about it. And that also become a hindrance to your concentration, to your further development. So that is why first we try to study along with the practice as well, so we can get rid of our doubt. When some experience, when something come up,
we know what it is already. Like we know these are the hindrances. We know this, how we can overcome this hindrance. The only way, now you see these five mental hindrances. How do you overcome these mental hindrances? How do you overcome these mental hindrances? Kamachanda. You overcome your sensual desire through the practice of mindfulness. When you have mindfulness, when you have strong mindfulness, you are mindful of your body, the nature of your body. Why we contemplate on the body always? When we contemplate on the body, we see the nature of the body. We see that it is constantly changing, and we see how filthy this body is. You think your body is nice, but you find that, you know, after if you don't wash your body for 2-3 days, you start smelling. You have to wash the body. And then what you eat and you wash the next day, what comes out of it? Very nice? You don't want to see also. You don't want to smell also. But before that, when you get the food, you see, smell. So you should see, and then you see, what is really in your body? Before it comes down, you know, it is in here, you know that? So you try to see, from the time the food comes into your mouth, and then this is how when you eat, this is another stage of contemplation we do. Another step we contemplate on our food. After chewing, after that, what we do is we contemplate and how the body, how the food mix with saliva, mix with, mix saliva, and then it goes down and mix with the enzyme in the stomach. After that, what happened? You begin to have, you know, very slimy. Have you seen it? Have you seen when the food go in the stomach? Can you see it? You know, sometimes when your body don't feel well and you vomit it out, can you see the vomit? And you want to vomit some more? That is really what happened. That is really what has happened to your food, no? Very nice. When the vomit come, can you take back again and put in? But it is in there. You cannot see it. If you can see it, this is how we contemplate on what you call the loathsomeness of the body. The loathsomeness of the body. The food gets in there. After that, you go on contemplating. It goes into the intestine. After it goes into the intestine, and then whatever color you eat, it becomes. You know what color when it comes up. So that is the nature of the food that goes into your body. Eventually it becomes that. So do you want, if you can see this, you will not cling to your food anymore. And then, because of our attachment to our body, all these sensual desires arise. We see the body as beautiful. Which part of the body that you think beautiful? You know, one day, one monk, you know, he, after he married, he realized some Dhamma and he became a monk. And then later on, one woman, woman went and became a nun. And then the husband still, you know, pursue her like that. And then chase after her. And then one day she asked, what is it that you want? You know? She says, oh, I love you. I like you very much. What is it that you love? What is it that you like? And then, this man says, you know, you have very beautiful eyes. You know, your eyes are very beautiful. And then she take out the eye and she give to him. Take, yeah, my eye. yes, true. After that, you know, she, the husband keep the eye. Very beautiful, you think? That's, you can contemplate. Now, in order to overcome that, you have to contemplate the sensual desire. It's very useful at a certain stage of your life. Huh? Most powerful way of birth control is by your scientific birth control of your mind. And when you have right contemplation, that's how you can control your lustful desires and thoughts. Like that. When you look at the body and you contemplate the hair of the body, huh? Kesa, loma, nasa, danta, tacho. There's some more, up to 32. But these five things are just external ones. You contemplate, and contemplate is nature. What you are seeing are all dead cells. But because of your deluded mind, you think, you condition it and you see very beautiful, but actually it is all dead cells already. You think the hair is very nice, and one day, like, you know, some of you who eat every day, one day you may see some hair in your, you know, in your soup or in the food there. And then you don't want to touch, you don't want to eat anymore. Why? If you say the hair is very beautiful, you know. That's why when you start analyzing and you analyze the body into different parts, you can see the nature of the body. That's how you can, with mindfulness, you can overcome your sensual desire and aversion. How do you overcome aversion? When you have faith, when you have confidence, huh? When you have faith, you develop your faith and confidence, you can, you have metta, you can overcome your aversion, anger. And how you overcome your sloth and torpor? Only way by exerting energy, effort to overcome sloth and torpor. How do you overcome udaccha kukkuccha, restlessness? Huh? When your mind is restless, you should concentrate. When there are many thoughts that come into mind, that is the time that you should bring your mind to one thing. You can bring it. Bring to one object. That's how you develop you overcome restlessness. A lot of thoughts in your mind. And then vichikicca, doubts. Doubts in your mind. How do you overcome doubts? Because of wisdom in the mind. Because of your wisdom, you can overcome the doubts in your mind. Huh? And this is how, when you learn, and you learn the method, you learn the way, but you must be patient, you must take time. Huh? And like, you know, sometimes you get a little bit, you want to learn everything in a hurry. Like you want to develop your metta, you want instant metta. You want to develop mindfulness, instant mindfulness. You want concentration, you want instant. Everything you want instant. Like instant coffee, instant meat, instant noodle. And no, if wisdom don't come like this, and it can come also if you have developed in the past. Like in the past, if you have developed it, you can sit and suddenly you can get into your concentration. That is because of the past conditioning the present, not because you just developed by fruit shop, you can. No, because of your past. Like now, if you develop more and more, then one day you get a sudden of course, when it happened suddenly. It just happened that way, you know. But first you must make it ripe, like that. Like the fruit on the tree, right? The mango, when it is green, it don't fall down so easily. They ripen, and then it fall down. Naturally, it fall down. Your wisdom arises like that too. Like the durian, you know. As long as it is not ripe, it won't fall down. But after some time, when it ripe, then it fall down. Your wisdom appear like that. But you must make your mind, more matured by right contemplation, by having right thought, metta, and then concentrate more and more like that. That's how you can overcome doubt. I think we will talk about these things more, because can you give me 5 more minutes? I will write 5 more things. Then later we can, yes, because this is how we will talk, when this is how we can understand what you call right concentration. You use your mental faculties to overcome the mental hindrances. When these mental hindrances are at least temporarily checked, temporarily you can overcome them, at least temporarily, then 5 mental factors arise in your mind. We call it the jhana factors. What are the 5 jhana factors? Vitakka. Vitakka means applied thought. Second one, vichara, means sustained thought. Then piti. We use still the word joy, but I put in inverted comma because it, you know, not really that kind of joy. But sometimes people use the word rapture. We'll explain what it is about. Then fourthly, sukham. Sukha means happiness. And fifthly, ekakkata. Ekakkata is one-pointedness. These are the 5 factors, jhana factors. This is how you get absorption, your mind get absorbed, and you attain the full concentration when these 5 mental factors arise. When your mental faculties you develop, you have balanced mental faculties, and you at least these mental hindrances, when the mental hindrances are not there in your mind, then these jhana factors arise. Right? First one is vitakka. You have to apply your thought. Like if you watch your breath, you are actually applying your thought on your breath, watching your breath. That's what you call applied thought. Right? Now when you apply your thought a little while, and then you get angry, applied thought disappear, right? Because hindrances is there. But if you can use effort and maintain your thought there and sustain it for longer time, sustain your thought, keep looking at the breath like that, naturally, then the mental hindrances are being suppressed at least temporarily. Then you get your sustained thought. If you can sustain your thought for some time, then you get the kind of, you get some energy, you feel, the enthusiasm, really the word is like enthusiasm, that you want to see it some more. Like I see some of you, some days when you see it and your mind is calm, and suddenly your body is very upright, and then tell you to open your eyes and be wide awake, you also feel like wanting to sit some more, haven't it? Because of PT. That is because of PT. Sometimes you feel like crawling sensation. Sometimes you feel tears like coming down. Sometimes you feel light, like you can float up like that. Sometimes bright, sometimes. These are different expressions of PT. just before you get into that happiness like that, just before you experience the real kind of joy there. And so when these factors arise, and then your mind is actually looking at one, looking at the object, just focusing at one point around the breath, and there is this one-pointedness too. When these factors are there, when these five factors are there, then we say you have like first jhana, like this, first jhana, first stage of absorption. And then when you keep on concentrating again, then the first two factors, vitaka, vichara, you don't have to apply your thought anymore, right? You don't have, because you cannot feel your breath anymore. No need to apply thought. You just have, you know, the piti, sukhang, ekagata. Then at that stage, you must look at piti. Piti is the feeling, the pleasant kind of feeling like that. You just look and observe the pleasant feeling and see how the pleasant feeling come and go, come and go, come and go like that. And when it come and go, you see it more and more, then you only see the pleasantness, more refined kind of pleasant feeling, sukhang. Don't get attached to that sukhang too. And you see how that even the kind of happiness also come and go when you watch it carefully, until your mind is just one, and your mind is clear, bright, and you feel, at this stage of sukhang, you will find that your body is very relaxed, no more pain, and your mind, no more, what you call stress, no more disturbance in your mind, like that. Your mind is very relaxed, you know, there's sukhang, and your body is light, you know, like that. And then, ekagata. Now, in real practice, in actual practice, we first start with, we start with these three things. Ekagata, because we must focus our attention on one point. We start with that. Although it does not fix there totally, but we have to start there. And then we apply the thought, and then we keep our thought there, like that. So these three things are the cause. Vitaka, vichara, ekagata, they are the cause. The other two, piti, sukhang, is the result of it, is the result from our practice. Understand? You should try and have a little bit more effort, and you can practice and this before you go back. I hope you can try and you practice, put a little bit more effort and to practice so that you can experience, you can get the real taste of Dhamma. The real taste of Dhamma is the taste of peace within you, the taste of real peace within you. After that, you will want more and more like that. More peace of mind, you will know what the Dhamma is really, and what you are learning like this. Never mind. I see sometimes some of you feel a bit tired because, like, some of you not used to attend to classes. We have very long classes, and some of you have given up your schooling long ago, and now you still have to sit down and attend class like this, and copy notes, so these are the things that not so used to, but if you force yourself, you know, that's why we must know our balance. We must know our balance. If our mind is not balanced, you see, like the children, you know, like children, they are used to, you know, they are used to copying notes. They like this kind of, they will copy notes, and they can study very well. And if you test them, they become very active like that. But for you people who have been working for a long time, and your mind is not that kind of studying mind. Your mind is not that kind of memorizing mind. In the past, we have tried to introduce. We make everybody study by heart certain stanza, and then we find they get headache and all kind of ache. You know, they become sick. So many of them become sick. So later I realize, later we realize that, you know, like, because there is tension arise, because they are not used to doing it. And some of them get angry, get irritated, like you can see sometimes, you know. And you must give metta, like that. We have to give metta. And you know, patience is the only way. If you have patience, you have endurance, you will see the good result. Like if you cannot wait, sometimes people come and then they want to study the thing that they want to study only that thing quickly. And then they wait and they cannot, like, they get fed up and they see everything. When their mind is angry and then they see everything no good like that. You know, they find fault with anything, everybody. Huh? And they feel very miserable like this. Oh, we should try. If we can, we should try to make the mind good again. When your mind is good, everything is good. Huh? When your mind is good, everything is good. When your mind is no good, everything is no good. You find fault with everybody except yourself. Huh? So please see this thing. I think you can learn many things. Not only by looking inside, you should see outside too. You can learn lessons from outside. I have, you know, the opportunity sometimes when I, you know, travel and when I do various courses, sometimes I see. And I see different people have different nature, different way. Huh? And some want to do this, some want to do that, like that. And you just study the nature like that. And when you study the nature, you can have more understanding that in this world there are so many different ways, so many people do different things like that, they want to do the way. And if we can help them, if they have confidence, if they have, you know, confidence, okay. Like if they don't want to listen, they have no confidence, they want to do the way, they have no patience, no reverence, like we cannot help them like that. Huh? We have no ulterior motive. We don't, like for example, you all come. We come here to study, and sometimes your mother asks you to come, sometimes your wife asks you to come. But you should realize that eventually it's good for you and you should get up. But if you still, up to now, you still think, you know, I come here, why my mother asked me to come. Like you feel very... And if you feel like that, you know, if you want to go home, can go home too, you know. you should take your initiative. You should use your initiative, like to learn. Make good use of the opportunity. And those of you who have taken a lot, you take leave to come here, please don't get upset by what you see, by what you hear. And just look inside you and try to, you know, from now onwards, you few days, you try to keep your mind calm and apply your mindfulness and try to reflect what you have learned and put into practice, and you will realize the thing. I hope you can realize very quickly too. And then we will revise again these things, how this thing can lead you to real absorption. This is what you call the right concentration. You have all these things, you have right concentration. When you have right concentration, you turn your concentration and you watch your mind and body. You watch whatever thoughts, whatever feeling, whatever. And then you see how it rise and fall, rise and fall. And then this is how you develop your wisdom. And we will talk again about bhavana and divide it into two, like samatha and vipassana. Now you have understood, we have talked about the general concept of bhavana, and then the different methods. We will talk a little bit more about the different methods and different ways by which we can practice to develop our wisdom and insight. And okay, all right. I think it's about time.